Welcome to Central Parkway Baptist Church on this beautiful last Sunday in February. I'm glad to see you here. The Lord Jesus Christ is the most important person in our service. Where two or more are gathered in my name, he says he will be amongst us, and so we are happy for that. And then after the Lord Jesus Christ, we hope that our guests and our visitors feel the love and the warmth and the welcome of our Central Parkway Baptist Church family. If you'd like to let us know how we could be in prayer with you or for you specifically, I'll encourage you to take a connection card and fill that out. And when the ushers come a little bit later to lead in a time of worshiping the Lord through tithes and offerings, you could deposit your connection card along with any offering you may have in the offering plate. We're thankful for last week, the time we had together after service for the Valentine's or the love, laughter, and lunch we had. Thank you to Deanna and everybody on that hospitality team that pitched in to make it a wonderful time. Really, it was beautiful. We had a sweet time together and looking forward to the next one. I commend the bulletin to you. There's lots going on and you don't want to miss out. And so you could take a look at this at your leisure and see how you could jump in and get involved in the life of the church. A few announcements. The ladies are having a breakfast the first Saturday of March, as they do every month. But this Saturday, pay close attention. They're meeting in the fellowship hall, not over at the restaurant where they usually meet, okay? And so that means, I believe it's more potluck style. There won't be waiters and waitresses to take your order. You'll have to bring something and share with the folks, and that'll be a nice time. Also, we're gearing up for our week of prayer for Annie Armstrong. That's a missions offering that 100% goes to support our missionaries on the field in North America. Okay, so we'll be hearing more about that as the weeks progress. Very good. Church, let's pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this time together in spirit and truth. Lord, I pray that you would capture our heart's affection and our mind's attention, that everything we do and say will be to your glory and honor. Father, you know exactly where we are in life, and you know what burdens we might carry. Help us, God, by faith to cast those upon you because you care for us. We worship and celebrate you today in Christ's name. Amen. Amen, church. Let's sing.
Good morning. Please stand if you're able, and let's worship the Lord.
Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. The King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord, forever his truth shall reign. exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is my Lord, forever His truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in Your holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. Exalted, the King is exalted on high.
Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God.
I will
church.
What an awesome day to be in the Lord's house. As we enter a time of worship through prayer today, our missionaries are serving in Thailand, Jason and Robin. How did they get there? How did they get to Thailand? I asked this in the first service. Anybody ever been to Thailand or from Thailand? Okay. The amazing thing about this is we talked about this in Sunday school. We were just discussing Matthew 9 and 10. In Thailand is a large Buddhist community. Why do missionaries go there? Because God calls us to take the gospel all around the world. Who created the world? God did. Who created Thailand? God did. The people that lived there were created by God. They had been influenced by other people. To being a Christian in Thailand and professing your faith in Jesus Christ could get you killed. Here's the amazing thing about that. People still go and they still share. Jason and Robin were praying for someone to help them in their local ministry. They met a young lady named Tia at a local coffee shop. They met her and they had coffee there every day. Many of us have done the same thing. Go to coffee shops, you engage people. But when you engage people with a purpose, they ended up sharing the gospel with her, with Tia, and it changed Tia's heart. But where does this all start with? It all starts with prayer. It all starts with having a conversation with the Father, with the Creator, with the person who knows what's going to happen tomorrow. Because here's the thing. Right now it is 11:13. We don't know what's going to happen at 11:15, 11:30, but God does. If you have that relationship with Him, you have that prayer with Him, you're in constant communication with Him, He is going to guide you in 5 minutes, in 10 days, in your lifetime. God is always working, even in the small places. Prayer gives you guidance, direction, healing, comfort. We take a few moments here at Central Parkway Baptist Church, and we have a time of prayer. Our lives are so busy, we're going to carve out about 3 or 4 minutes of silent prayer. Please pray for missionaries like Jason and Robin. Continue to pray for peace in Jerusalem and the Middle East. Pray for peace in the United States of America. Because we have a leadership that can't solve the issues. We have government that can't solve the issues. Here's the amazing thing. You ready? God can. God is the only one that can put down and do away with what's going on in this country. We need to have those conversations. Now, for those that are Central Parkway family, please pray for Bailey Carlin. That's Paul and Sheila's grandson. The USS John McCain set sail on Friday in his destroyer. They are going to the Red Sea and replacing the ship that is under constant missile attacks. He is going there to replace that ship so he can come back for repair. A little scary, right? But like I told Sheila, I told Paul, I said, man, we can't be there with Bailey, but God is. We can't be on that ship, but we just need to pray for that. We need to pray for what's going on in this country, around this world. And I heard that this week before we go into our prayer time. The amount of bombs that were dropped in Israel didn't stop the battle. Only God can stop that. So we need to pray for peace, for God's presence. Let's take a few moments. Let's bow our heads. Let's have those conversations. Share your thoughts, your successes, your failures. And I'll come back and close this shortly. Thank you. Most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you. We thank you for this moment. This moment that you have created. Lord, that you have brought us here, brothers and sisters from all over this country, all over this world, together for these few moments, Lord. Lord, I thank you for my brothers and sisters that are here right now, Lord. But Lord, I am a sinner. We all are sinners. We all have fallen short of your glory, Lord. We have given in to the glitter and the flash of this world. But Lord, through your love for each one of us, your commitment, your mercy, and your grace, your Son was nailed to that tree who died for me, for each one of us. His blood will make us as white as snow. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for never giving up on us, Lord. Lord, we deserve the punishment. But Lord, we get your grace. We get your mercy, Lord. Lord, we pray for missionaries today, like Jason and Robin, that are serving in an area that could get them killed. But Lord, you place them there to share your love, your mercy, your grace. Lord, they are mirroring you. Lord, thank you. Thank you for them. Lord, I ask for your presence, your peace, your comfort, your shield in Jerusalem and all around the Middle East, Lord. Lord, that the wars that are going on, that have been going on for thousands and thousands of years that have never been completed, only you have stopped the wars. You have brought peace. Lord, we pray your peace upon that area, Lord. Lord, I pray for Bailey. I pray for all his shipmates, the men and the women of the USS John McCain. Lord, as there is anxiety there, as there is the uncertainty of what is going to happen, Lord. But Lord, you are already there. You already know. Lord, we pray for each one of them. We pray for their families. Yes, the soldiers go off to war, but the families are going to battle as well. We pray for moms and dads and grandparents, for brothers and sisters, for wives and partners, Lord, that they would be comforted by you, Lord. Lord, I pray for each one that's sitting in this room right now. Lord, the challenges of life that are happening, Lord, be with them. Surround them, comfort them. We pray for this nation. Lord, we thank you for your guidance. Lord, we thank you for your healing. We thank you for your direction. And as we continue to worship you, open our hearts and our minds so you would have. In your Son's name, amen.
Please stand if you're able and join us for our third song.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of his servant Moses, righteous speaking.
Sorry, excuse me. Completely off key, my mistake. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for bringing us all here, Father. Thank you for allowing us, Lord, to worship you, Father. And I pray, Lord, that we'll be able to give you our best, Father. We can't give you perfect, Lord, but we can give you our best, Father. And Lord, I pray we'll all be able to worship you in spirit and in truth, to give you the highest praises, Father, highest honor and the highest glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword. Still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There is no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Amen. Glory to God. You may be seated.
Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're about to give back to you a small portion of what you've so graciously given, Lord. Lord, bless the gift and the giver. In your Son's name, amen. Thank you.
have your Bibles with you, you could turn to the Gospel of Mark and find chapter 8. We'll be reading verses 31 through 38. Mark 8, 31 through 38. The words of the scripture will also be projected on the monitors that are behind me. You could follow along that way as well. The word of the Lord. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." May the Lord bless the reading of his word to our hearts and our minds for understanding, but also our hands, so that we're not only hearers of the word of God, but also doers of God's word. So you probably heard the question raised to you as a child, which came first, the chicken or the egg, right? It's a common question, an old question, centuries, millennia old. And of course, it's a question regarding causality or cause and effect. What cause made this effect, right? What happened? Which came first? When we think about the topics of life and death, we naturally don't think there's any kind of contradiction or no need for a question of which came first, life or death. Because, of course, in the natural scheme of things, right, we're born, and then we live, and then at some point, right, nobody's getting out alive, we all die. So, of course, life comes before death. Now, if you've been to a Christian funeral, you acknowledge or realize that it's a core Christian belief that death is not the end of the story, right, that there is a heavenly life, a fuller life, a greater life. Paul said, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain, is more." And so we understand that usually in church when we talk about life after death, we're talking about that heavenly state after somebody breathes their last, so to speak. But as we look at the text today, we see that there's more to the story, or there's another way of looking at this statement or this idea behind life after death. It seems like Jesus is saying, maybe much like the conundrum of the chicken and the egg, that before we live a true life or an abundant life now, today, I came that you might have life and have it abundantly, says the Lord in John chapter 10, that there appears to be a kind of death that has to take place before that life could take place, right? We often talk about the experience of becoming a Christian as being born again or being saved or getting a new life, but we rarely think of it in the terms that Jesus is referring to here of first experiencing or enduring or going through a certain kind of death. So it seems like Jesus is saying to his disciples and to the crowds that are listening to him at the time that in order to truly live, first, you have to die, a kind of death, right? Now, what's Jesus talking about? That in order to truly live in this life, one has to experience a certain kind of death. And ultimately, he concludes here with an invitation to follow him and the promise of following Jesus through this death or through this suffering offers this promise of a true life or a transformation. What's Jesus talking about? Well, I think like Peter in the passage, first we have to deal with our common human misconceptions about what Jesus is talking about when he's talking about life and death. What are our common misconceptions? Now, upon hearing what Jesus stated, and it's interesting how the Bible says there that he stated it plainly, right? Jesus talked about these things plainly. Verse 32, and he said this plainly. There's instances or there's times in Jesus' teaching with his disciples and with the crowd that maybe it's not as plain, right? Maybe he speaks in a parable that's difficult to understand, or his teaching could be interpreted in such a way that's maybe not literal, but more spiritual or figurative, and so it's sometimes difficult to see where he's going or where he's coming from. But here, the gospel writer, Mark, tells us what Jesus said about being rejected by the religious establishment, right? The scribes, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, being rejected by them and being or undergoing suffering and then ultimately dying, that this was plain, that there was no other way to take Jesus' words. The disciples couldn't think that he was talking figuratively or spiritually, that when Jesus said they were going to reject him, that he was going to suffer, and that he was going to die, that was a plain enough way of saying it that Peter understood that Jesus is looking at dying and saying that his ministry or a part of his ministry is that of suffering and death. Now, one of the reasons Peter reacts so strongly saying that can't happen is because Jesus just blessed him by saying that God revealed to him this truth, this heavenly truth, this eternal truth that Jesus is the Messiah. And so Peter's having a difficult time correlating the two or putting synthesizing these two realities, that Jesus is at the same time the Messiah and at the same time planning on experiencing some severe trauma, some antagonism from the religious establishment and from suffering and even ultimately to death. So, of course, Peter does not understand what's going on. And I think that's related to a misconception that we have, even if it's subtly, and even if we don't might say this overtly, right? We understand or we believe that if we're going through some difficulty, if we're experiencing trouble, if we're experiencing suffering, that there must be something off or something's wrong, right? When the check engine light comes on, hello, you got to take it over to the mechanic and he's got to inspect it because you want that car to keep running. And so if Jesus is getting this ministry going, this teaching, he's exercising demons, he's healing people and all kinds of great things, and suddenly he seems to be putting the brake on it saying, I'm going to suffer now. Yes, I'm the Messiah. God revealed that to you, but now it's going to come time for rejection and suffering and death. Peter says, no. In Luke's account of the parallel story, he pretty much says that's far from you, or that's not God's will for you. It's not God's will for you to suffer, to be rejected, and to die. We understand that from a human perspective, right? If somebody, a dear friend, a loving family member, somebody close to you says that they have such and such condition, which is going to lead to their demise, a terminal diagnosis maybe, your first reaction is shock and say, no, that's not what's going to happen. You have to get a second opinion. You have to get another report, right? That can't be right. And a lot of that has to do with how that's going to affect our lives, affect our relationship with that person, affect our well-being, our emotional stability. So from that perspective, we understand where Peter is coming from. We could empathize with him. But when Jesus quickly rebukes him, and I want you to notice the body language, he's talking with Peter face to face, and Peter says, this can't be. You're not going to be rejected. You're not going to suffer. You're not going to die. He gives him a strong rebuke. Jesus does what? In speaking with Peter, what does he do? He turns his back to him, and he looks at the disciples, and he calls Peter Satan. It's a temptation. We talked about the temptations last week that the Lord experienced in the desert. It's a temptation to believe that God's will isn't for him to suffer. It's a temptation for him to believe that he could have all the bread he wants. It's a temptation for him to believe that God will always protect his life, that he won't let his foot dash upon the rock. It's a temptation for Jesus to believe that he could have anything and all the kingdoms and all the control he wants. And so the voice of the enemy, the adversary, is ringing in Jesus' ears through the mouth of Peter. Denying, hiding, ignoring pain and suffering and death are not God ideas, but they're our idea, our false self's idea. It's a way to protect ourselves. And that's the second, I think, more subtle or maybe more obvious misconception, that we believe we are someone we are not. We believe we are someone that we're not. In other words, Peter had this image of Jesus. Peter had this idea, this conception about who Jesus is, what was Jesus going to do as Messiah. He had this idea of Jesus, his image of Jesus that wasn't really Jesus. And I think with that, he had an idea about himself that was wrapped around this false idea of Jesus that really wasn't who he was, but he had invested. Listen, he had sacrificed. He left his fishing job. He left everything behind. He was now maybe an enemy of the Roman Empire by following this guy, definitely an enemy of the Jewish establishment. And so to say that Peter hadn't sacrificed and left behind everything to follow Jesus isn't an accurate statement, but he was wrapping his false identity around a false identity of Jesus. I'm the right-hand man. I'm the leader of the disciples. Whatever other thing he was envisioning about who he was, his importance in this whole thing. I think we have a lot to learn here from the Lord and from Peter, because I think America is a self-obsessed nation or made up of self-obsessed individuals. I mean, our generation has seen the dawn of the selfie, right? How many pictures of ourselves do we need to post on social media? And why are we doing it? I understand if you're a teenager and you're learning about who you are, your identity, you're gaining your self-identity and what, but somebody, you know, my age, I don't think there's really a point to that except to show how self-absorbed we are as a nation or as an individual, as people. We believe in this idea of a self-made man or self-made woman. That's American, right? That's the frontiersman, the rugged individualism, right? If I'm going to make my way in this world, I'm going to be self-made. I'm going to do it my way, and I don't need anybody's help. I'm going to strike it the rich. I'm going to make my way, make a name for myself, all these things. I read a book a while back, and it kind of, when I was studying, it kind of reminded me of a book by Malcolm Gladwell called Outliers. and it's the story of success. And what most people have taken from that book is that the 10,000 hour concept, that in order to be successful at anything, you have to spend 10,000 hours practicing that thing. And he shows evidence how everybody from the Beatles to concert pianists or violinists, and anybody who's achieved any level of success in any field has poured about 10,000 hours in that field. And that is one of the conclusions in his book. But the other conclusions are, the other things that are attributed to success have nothing to do with you. You have to be born at the right place and at the right time and be around the right people. That has nothing to do with who you are in order to be a success at something. I don't want to belabor the point, but one of his first illustrations in the book is about hockey players. Anybody play hockey? Anybody from Canada? Canadian friends? No? Anyway, I think it's like, I don't quote me here. You could look it up in the book, but I think he said over 70% of professional hockey players are born, have their birth dates in January, February, or March. 70% of professional hockey players are born in the first quarter of the year. So if you're going to be a professional hockey player, you better hope and pray that you're born January, February, March. How many of you picked the month you were born? No, that's a problem. Hey, if you want to be a hockey player, that's a problem. Now, why is that? How does it make sense that you have to be born in the first quarter of the year to be a professional hockey player? Why is that? Well, when you enter the first league as a child, you're put in that league by the year you were born. So somebody born December 31st, 2023, is playing with people born January 1st, 2023. And so there's 11 months, almost a whole year of difference of development, right? Of coordination, of strength. Who's going to get the attention of the coaches and of the special teams and of the people that are looking in Canada, serious business, to develop hockey players? The more coordinated, the stronger, the bigger players. Those are the ones that get special attention. Those are the ones that get put on special teams. So listen, I'm sorry, but if you were born in the second or third or fourth quarter of the year, likely you're not going to become a professional hockey player. Now, why did I get it all that? Oh, yeah. Because of this false self situation, right? This who we are is not really who we are. It's our common misconception that it's not God's will for us to suffer. So we deny suffering, we fear suffering, we avoid suffering at all costs, because there's no way that God could be involved in it. If I'm suffering, I must not be faithful enough, knowledgeable enough, or holy enough, obedient enough. That's why I'm suffering. That's a misconception. That's a lie. And the other misconception is I am this person that I'm building, this identity that I'm developing. Jesus addresses this, right? When he turns his back on Peter and addresses his disciples, telling them that Peter was not setting his mind on God, but on the things of man. Again, just a minute ago, he was revealed, he had the revelation from God that Jesus was the Messiah. And Jesus said, flesh and bone, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you. But here he turns to the crowd, verse 34, and he said, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his life? For what can a man give in return for his life? And so then Jesus talks about our common call. Our common call. Right? For Jesus, the way that he rebukes Peter and tries to bring him back in line, so to speak, or trying to bring him back into discipleship. And for the rest of us, because he looks at the crowd and he says, listen, the path to following me, if you want to follow me, is to deny yourself. The way you could translate that word deny is to destroy that self. Destroy the self. That self that says that suffering cannot be God's will. That self that says, I've done it my way, I've made it on my own. This is who I am. This is my identity. Everything that I've gathered, all my possessions, my family, all these things that we think identify us as individuals, Jesus says, you have to deny that. You have to destroy that. Now, when we hear that statement by Jesus, when you hear Jesus turn to the crowd and say, if anyone were to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me, right? What we tend to hear by that in church life, in religious life, is not so much self-denial, but self-improvement. That's the tendency, to say, I admit that there's things that are wrong with myself. I believe that Jesus is a good teacher, and he shows a good path, and he's a righteous man. And so in order to follow Jesus, I have to become better. I have to improve myself by studying or by trying harder, by being nicer. These are the things I have to do. And what we end up with is not so much self-denial, but again, self-improvement at its best, maybe self-righteousness at its worst. If you go to the Christian bookstore, whether you do so in person with a brick and mortar or online, you could see just how many Christian books, and lots of books really, are dedicated to that idea of self-improvement. But self-denial is not self-improvement. Self-denial is not self-righteousness. But another extreme that we go to is asceticism, right? We think that denying ourselves, that Jesus is talking about denying basic physical human needs, that we have to go out and live in a monastery somewhere and live on a strict diet, maybe like John the Baptist, only ate locust and honey, only wore certain clothing. That's what it means to deny ourselves, to give up things that we like, give up necessities, and maybe even to a worse extent, self-mutilation. Like there's people that take a whip to their back or punish their bodies in order to deny themselves. But listen, if we look at the life and the story of our Lord, he's no ascetic, right? He's not an ascetic. Jesus' first miracle took place at a wedding. When they ran out of wine, he made some more, right? That doesn't sound like an ascetic. Jesus was oftentimes castigated by the religious authority, by the religious leadership. Why? Because he was dining and feasting with sinners. So Jesus wasn't an ascetic. So self-denial is not self-righteousness. It's not self-improvement. And it's also not asceticism. What is it then? When Jesus says, if anyone were to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me, for whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his life, right? What is that? What is that self-denial that Jesus is talking about? What is that self-destroying the self? We have a picture of it, right? During our second service, which is our Spanish service, we had the wonderful opportunity to witness a believer's baptism by immersion, and it was three new believers who Pastor Omar submersed in water and then brought them back out of the water, right? And we all celebrated, we all clapped, because that's a picture of the reality. That's our symbol. That's our ritual for what Jesus is talking about here, right? It's dying to self. It's being buried, burying the old self, the old man, the flesh, however you want to say it, and rising up to live in our true identity or our true reality, which is spirit, which is Christ. It's dying to self and living in Christ. There was an old track, and I don't think it's a perfect track, and I'm not preaching on the track, but it was, I think it was the Campus Crusade track, the Four Spiritual Laws. You're familiar with it? There's a picture in there of a throne, and it has an S on the throne, and the S stands for self, right? And it says to become a follower of Christ means that S is not on the throne. Oh, and it has Christ, or it has a cross outside the circle. And then it says, that's not the Christian life, and it isn't. But then it says, it puts the cross on the throne of life. And then the S shrinks, and it's next to the throne. And so the idea is that our identity, our true identity, is Christ. And that's how we are to live out of this identity, this reality that we are spirit, right? Walk not by the spirit, walk not by the flesh, but walk by the spirit. The only problem is they don't put the little S outside the circle. They keep it in the circle. I think what Jesus is saying is we have to get rid of the little S. Now, in reality, the little S sticks around, you know, trying to get attention back, trying to seek to grow itself and all those things. But we are to render it as dead. Paul says in Galatians chapter 2, I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives within me. In the life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I guess another example before I move on is we've all had friends. Do you remember just how important, particularly growing up and in grade school and in high school, your friends were? I mean, you lived and died. A lot of people lived and died by what their friends did or said or believed about them. Our identities were wrapped so tightly around who we hung out with. And we did well or we did not so well, depending on what? Who we hang out with, right? Tell me who you're with and I'll tell you who you are. That's what my mom always said, but in Spanish. If you tell me who you're with, I'll tell you who you are. That's your identity. That's what she would say. And it's just amazing. Now, fortunately, and some people are different. But for most of us, a lot of those people that we lived and died for, that were the center of our universe, are no longer really influential in our lives anymore, right? We don't necessarily keep up with this person that we once called our best friend. Yeah. Anybody could relate to that? Does anybody no longer hang out with or know that childhood bestie, maybe? Yeah. You know, I think a lot of us. And that's, I think, how it is with the self, right? When we come into Christ, when we see who we truly are, when we capture our true identity in Christ, it's not necessarily that the self dies, but But we render it as dead. It's no longer influential. It no longer is in the driver's seat. It's no longer on the throne because it just no longer is that influential. Every once in a while, we might get a Facebook notification about our friend. They got a different job or they moved or whatever, but it really doesn't have anything to do with our life now. That's what Jesus is saying. Listen, deny yourself. Pick up your cross. There's no questioning what he was talking about to those people. When he said, pick up your cross, the people knew what he was talking about, that they were walking towards their death by carrying their cross, that the cross is an instrument of torture and punishment and death, and that the people carrying it were going to die. And that's what Jesus is inviting us to do. The result could be our common hope, our common hope. There's a parallel passage in John chapter 12, verse 24 through 26. I think it worth reading here. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. When we recognize that we've undergone or we've experienced this death of the false self, or this little s, then life becomes much wider and broader and brighter. High definition living. When we talked about Jacob saying, I didn't realize that this was the house of God. It was here all along. I didn't see it. I was in it, but I didn't see it. When Moses saw that the bush was ablaze, when the disciples on the mountain of transfiguration saw Jesus from the perspective that God sees Jesus, living this transformation, living this resurrection life today means seeing and hearing from God's perspective, from God's point of view. And that's why Jesus is able to say, listen, I'm the Messiah, and as the Messiah, I'm going to enter into this period of suffering, of being rejected, and of dying, because he knew that it was by entering into suffering that he could alleviate suffering. How many times do we sing that? How many times do we worship and praise God for what he's done for us through Jesus, right? We talk about that all the time. What Jesus is inviting us to do here is to recognize that we're not the puny, limited, frightened, need protecting self, but we're the Christ self, we're the eternal self. And so we could enter into the suffering of other people in ways that are creative, in ways that we couldn't otherwise imagine, to help alleviate their suffering, because ultimately they're our brothers, they're our sisters, they're our family in God. So it's an invitation to follow Jesus, to come alongside and to participate in the ministry, in the life of Jesus Christ. Notice the invitation again, and I'll conclude here, is to follow him. I hope that I was plain, although it could be difficult to speak plainly, but what Jesus is inviting us here is not necessarily to believe in a particular doctrine or to study in a particular way, but to follow him. To live a Jesus life. And the way we could do that is because we are our true identities. We are a Jesus life. And we can experience that when we pick up our cross and die so that we could truly live. Let's pray. Gracious and Heavenly Father, thank you for inviting us together here today and allowing us to sing common songs, sharing a common hope, hearing a common word, and having a common invitation. That in our corner of the world, in our neighborhood, in our job, in our school, that we don't have to continue on the charade that we're living as someone we're not, but that by faith we could live in this creative, playful posture of entering into the world in a way that, Father, is impactful and loving and compassionate towards others. We thank you for the rebuke that you gave to Peter and that you give to us. Father, would we not rather live in this false identity and gain a whole false world? Help us, Father, to live a true and abundant life beginning now. We thank you, God, for not shrinking back from suffering, but for entering into our suffering. And Father, help us by the courage, the faith of our Lord to enter into the suffering and the pain of others to help alleviate. We love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing our hymn of invitation, I Surrender All.
To Jesus I surrender all, to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him.
Assignments for you before you go. Of course, if you notice somebody who's visiting with us for the first time, or you don't recognize somebody, be sure that they don't leave here without being greeted warmly with our Central Parkway Baptist Church family. I want to recognize Dr. Gerald Wright, his wife Kathy, dear friends of mine from Palm Beach County. Theology professor, missionary, all around, great guy, great couple. Kathy's worked as a social worker in her professional life. And anyway, they're enjoying retirement in Georgia. And right, Georgia? Yes? Yeah. And are here this week escaping some cold weather. So welcome, folks. Don't head out before you're able to greet folks and let them know how happy you are that they were here today. If you look around, there's a few of our folks that maybe are under the weather for one reason or another, couldn't make it today. So be sure, if you notice that someone's not here that's usually here, give them a call this week and let them know that you missed them, okay? May the Lord bless you and keep you, cause His face to shine upon you, be gracious to you, lift up His countenance upon you, and give you peace. Church, we'll see you real soon.